invited my journey and thought to just share some of the events that happened recently in my life.
So please pardon my voice, it's a bit hoarse because of the chemo. Okay, I'll just begin to say that I'm a typical product of today's society. You know, before this, saying about how the media influences, etc. So I'm typically a product of what the media portrays. Okay, from young, I've always been under the influence and impression that to be happy is to be successful. Okay, happy to successful is to be rich and wealthy. So I live my life according to this motto, coming from a poor average family. And back in those days, was highly competitive, whether it's in sports, in studies, in leadership, I won it all. Okay, so I've been there, done that, but at the end of the day, it's still about money. So in my recent years, the last few years, I was a trainee in ophthalmology, but I was growing a lot of impatience because I was looking at friends of mine who go into the private practice, making tons of money, and they were all stuck in the traineeship. So I said, okay, enough, it's getting too long. Okay. At the time, there was this search of prominence of aesthetic medicine. You know, I'm sure you're aware, aesthetic medicine became a big thing over the last few years. And I saw good money in there. You know, so much so I said, forget about ophthalmology. I'm going to do aesthetic medicine. Okay, so that's what I did. You know, the truth is nobody makes heroes out of the average Joe, the average GP in the neighborhood. They don't care. You know, they make heroes out of rich celebrities, wealthy politicians, rich and famous people. So I wanted to be one of this, and I dive straight into aesthetic medicine. You know, people are not willing to pay when I was doing locum, you know, back in those days. Anything more than $30. They say, oh, see a locum, see a guia. Very expensive. They make noise, they are not happy. But the same people, they are willing to pay $10,000 for a liposuction. So I say, well, let's stop healing the sick. I'm going to become a beautician. Okay? A medically trained beautician. And that was what I do. Liposuction, breast augmentation, eyelid surgeries, you name it, we do it. It was very good money. Okay. My clinic, when I started out, waiting time was 1 week, became 1 month, became 2 months, became 3 months. There was so much demand, people were literally queuing up to have aesthetic done on them. You know, women, easy money. So the clinic grew. I was so overwhelmed. So I employed one doctor, then two doctors, then three doctors, then four doctors, and carry on. You know, never is enough. You know, you wanted more and more and more. So much so that I even set up shop in Indonesia to lure all the Indonesian Thai ties. You know, we set up shop, set up a team of people there to get more Indonesian patients to come in, etc. So I was like, whoa, you know, things are going well. I'm there. My time has arrived. Earlier this year in February, I said, okay, I'm done. I have so much spare cash. It's time to get my first Ferrari. You know, so there was paperwork getting ready for the deposit. Okay, here comes my Ferrari. As Danny can testify to that. I was looking for land with him and a few of my friends. I got a banker friend who makes $5 million a year. He said, hey bro, come, let's get together. Let's buy some land and build our house. I said, yeah, let's do it. You know? And I was like, am I prime? Getting ready to enjoy and all. Now, about the same time, bro said that Danny had a revival. They had gone back to church with some of my close friends. And they told me, hey Richard, come, join us, come back to church. You know? I have been a Christian for about 20 years. I was baptized 20 years ago. But it was because it was fashionable to be a Christian. And all my friends will become Christian. I said, oh, it's getting fashionable. You know, I wanted to be baptized. Become one of Christians. You can feel in the form, they say religion, you know, they put in Christianity. It feels great. In truth, I've never read the Bible. I don't know what the Bible is all about. You know, I went to church for a while. After a while, I got tired. I said, okay, I have time to go to NUS. Stop going to church. I got a lot more things to pursue at NUS. Girls, studies, sports, etc. And after all, you know, I've achieved all these things without God today. So who needs God? You know, I myself, I can achieve anything I want. You know, in my arrogance, I told Danny, you know what, you go ahead and tell your pastor, change his sermon to 2 p.m. I will consider coming to church. Such arrogance. And I said one statement in additional to that, which today, I don't know if I have regretted saying that. I told Danny and my friends, you know, if God really wanted me to come back to church, he will give me a sign. Lo and behold, 3 weeks later, I was back in church. In March this year, out of the blue, nowhere, you know, I was still running around because I'm a gym freak. I always go to the gym, training, running, swimming, 6 days a week. I had some backache, and that's all I had, but it was persistent, you know. And so I just went for MRI, just to exclude any prolapse disc. And the day before I had the scan, I was still in the gym, lifting heavy weights, doing my squats. And the next day, they found that half my spine was at a marrow, bone marrow replacement. I was like, whoa, sorry, what's that? We had a PET scan done the next day, and they diagnosed that I had a terminal lung cancer, stage 4B. It has already spread to the brain, to half the spine. The whole lungs was all filled with tumors, liver, adrenals. See? Can't be, I was just at the gym last night. What's going on? So, I'm sure you know how it feels. I don't know, actually, you know how it feels. Okay, one moment there, I was there at the peak. And the next day, this news came and I was just totally devastated. You know, the whole world just turned upside down. I couldn't accept it, you know. I have 100 relatives on both sides, my mom and my dad, 100 of them. And not a single one of them has cancer. You know, to me, in my mind, I have good genes. You know? Good genes. You know, I'm not supposed to be having this. Some of my relatives are heavy chain smokers. Why am I having lung cancer? I was in denial. You know? Extreme denial. So, next day, you know, the day after, still in a state of denial, and I'm still unable to accept what's going on, still asking myself. There I was lying in the operating theatre in the hospital. What they did was a needle biopsy. They need to do the histology. So there I was, just completed the biopsy, and lying in the operating theatre, the nurses and the doctors have left. They say, you know, you can wait for about 15 minutes to check on the chest x-ray, you know, make sure there's no pneumothorax after the biopsy. So there I was lying on the table, staring blankly, you know, at the ceiling, in a cold, quiet OT. And suddenly I just heard this inner voice, you know. It was not like coming from outside, right? It's just a very strong inner voice that I've never felt at the moment. And it said very specifically, it said that, you know, this has to happen to you at your prime, because it was the only way, because it is the only way you can understand. I said, whoa, where did that come from? You know, when we speak to ourselves, we say, okay, what time should I leave this place? Or where should I have dinner after this? We speak from a first person point of view. We don't say, where should you go after this? Where's this voice that came? It speaks from a third party. It says, this has to happen to you at your prime because it is the only way you can understand. I was overwhelmed, you know, emotions just overflow. I broke down, I cried, alone there, and I knew days subsequently, you know, what it means to understand that why this is the only way. Because I was just so full of myself, you know, the whole life. I needed nobody else, you know. I was gifted with things that I can do. Why do I need anybody else? You're so full of yourself that there's just no other way I could have turned back to God. No other way. In fact, if I was diagnosed with stage 1 or 2, I'd be looking around busily for the best cardiothoracic surgeon. Remove a section of the lobe, open lobectomy, do a chemo preventive chemotherapy. The chances of it to be cured, extremely high. Who needs God? You know? But at terminal stage 4B, no man can help you. Only God can. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a series of events happens after that. I wasn't sold to that because of the inner voice that became, you know, believing in prayers and that. No, I wasn't. To me, it was just, maybe, you know, there was a voice, maybe that was me talking to myself. I didn't buy the story. Okay. And what happened next was, I was being prepared for chemotherapy. I started off with a whole brain radiation, radiotherapy first. It takes about 2-3 weeks. In the meantime, they prepared me for chemotherapy, supplements and all. And one of the things they used for chemo was this thing called Zumita. Zumita, they use it to strengthen the bones. You know, once the bone marrow replacement, the cure of the cancer cells becomes hollow. So you need to strengthen the bone to prevent compression fractures. Trouble is, one of the side effects of Zumita is that it can cause osteonecrosis of the jaw. You know? And I had to have the wisdom tooth removed. Years ago, I had the upper wisdom tooth removed because it gave me trauma. The lower one didn't give me any trouble, so I said, forget it, just leave it. So of course, Danny volunteered to remove it for me. Okay. So then I was lying there on the dental chair asking myself, you know, suffering all the side effects of radiotherapy, and now I have to go through wisdom tooth surgery as if I'm not bad enough to suffer. So I asked Danny, hey bro, you know, is there any other way? Can I go? Don't go through this. Say yes. You can pray. I said, what's there to lose? Pray, right? Okay, Lord, let's pray. And so we prayed. And we did X-ray after that, you know, just to get rid. Everything was all there, all the appliances, everything. But lo and behold, the X-ray showed there was no wisdom tooth in the lower jaw. Well, I know most people do have 4 wisdom tooth. Maybe some have none. But to have missing one or two, as I understand, I'm not too sure, but as I understand, it is not as common. Still, else, you know, I didn't care about that. Like, to me, so long as I learn to take out the tooth, I'm happy. Lots of joy. Okay. I haven't, see, at this point, I'm still not sold on prayers, right? Or maybe it's just a coincidence, you know, for whatever it's worth. Okay. And, you know, continue meeting my oncologist, asking him, so how long do I have? I ask him. Not more than 6 months. He said, even with chemotherapy, about 3 to 4 months, he says. No, I can't grasp that. You know, it's a bit difficult to come to terms. So even though as I went through the radio, I was struggling every day, especially in the morning, wake up. Hoping that it was just a nightmare, when you wake up, it's all over. Sorry, that didn't happen. As I was struggling day over day, I went into depression, which is, you know, the typical denial and depression and blah, blah, blah that you go through. But for one reason, I don't know why, there was this specific day that I was supposed to meet my oncologist in the afternoon at about 2 p.m. Okay, I felt this sudden surge of peace, comfort, you know. In fact, a little happiness, in fact, you know, it just overflowed me for no rhyme or reason. It just came at about 2 p.m. as I was getting ready, dressing up to meet my oncologist. So much so that I actually do the WhatsApp to all my friends, including Danny. I said, hey, brothers, I just feel so good suddenly. I don't know why. It just came, you know. And it was only days, I think, or was it weeks after that Danny revealed to me that he has fasted for 2 days. You know, for me. And he was bargaining with God and fasted for 2 days. And he ended his fast at the exact same point, about there, about 2 p.m., before this surge of sensation just came to me with no rhyme or reason. And I didn't even know that he was fasting for me at the point in time. And when he ended the fast, I felt that sensation, you know. So, whoa, okay, things are getting a bit too coincidental, you know. I'm starting to buy a bit of the story. But still, I wasn't so. And days passed by, blah, blah, blah. And I completed my radiotherapy over about 2 weeks plus. Getting ready for chemo. So they let me rest a few days. You see, lung cancer, the mortality rate of lung cancer, lung cancer has the highest number one mortality rate. If you add up breast, colon cancer, and prostate cancer, the top few cancers in Singapore for men and women. If you add up the mortality rate of these three, it still doesn't add up to the lungs. Simply because you understand, you can remove the prostate, the colon, the breast, you can't remove your lungs. See? But there's about 10% of lung cancer patients who do pretty well for some reasons, because they have this specific mutation. Okay, we call it the EGFR mutation. And it happens only, or mostly, 90% of the time, in Asian ladies who never smoke in their life. Me, first of all, I'm male. Secondly, I'm a social smoker. I take one a day after dinner. Weekends, my friend offers me, I take it as well. Yes, I'm a light smoker, a light social smoker, but still, my oncologist was not hopeful for me to have this mutation. The chances of it happening for me was like maybe 3%, 4% to get it. That's why I was being primed to go for chemo. But through all the intense prayer of friends, Danny, and even people that I do not even know, it turned out that during my waiting for the chemo, that my results came back and I was deemed as EGFR positive. You know? I was like, whoa, good news, because now I don't have to undergo chemo at the time. Because there's this oral tablet that you can control this disease. Okay, just to share with you some idea. Just give me a minute. This is a CT scan thorax of my lungs before treatment. Can you see?
Yeah.
Okay. See over there. Every single dot there is a tumor. Right? You can see all the mass to the. This is just one single plane. Literally, I have it in both lungs, and we're talking about very tens of thousands of tumors in the lungs. And that's why the oncologist told me, even with chemo at most, 3 to 4 months. But because of this mutation, they have this oral medication. This is what happens after about 2 months of treatment. As you can see over here. Over here, okay? You can see over there. This is what God can do. Okay. And that's why I'm still here, having this opportunity to share with you. Okay. As you can see over here, the difference between before and after treatment. At that point, I say, well, it's to be expected, isn't it? You know, the medicine is good. I'm still not buying the story. Well, you guys pray for me and all, you know. And so I begin to recover. Okay, the tumor markers start to come down. 90% of the tumors, more than 90%, were wiped out. The tumor markers came down by more than 90% over the next few months. But still, I know, you know, the trouble is once you have clinical knowledge, you know the statistics of 1 year survivor, 2 year survivor. And having all this knowledge is not a good thing. You know? Because you live with the knowledge that even with all this, your cells, the mutation, I mean the cancer cells are so You know, they mutate so much, they're so unstable, they keep mutating, that eventually they will overcome the resistance of your drugs. And then you're on to the next drug. Eventually, you're going to run out of medication. So living with this knowledge is a huge mental struggle. It's a huge mental torture. And cancer is not just about physical torture. It's a huge mental torture. And how do you live with no hope? How do you live with not able to plan for the next few years? When your oncologist tell you to plan with me for the next 1-2 months. So it's a lot of struggle as I went through March and then April. And April there was my lowest point. I was in deep depression, struggling even as I was recovering. And one of that day, you know, I was there in bed, struggling in the afternoon, asking God, why is it me? Why do I have to go through this suffering? Why do I have to endure this hardship and struggles and all? Why me, you know? And as I fell asleep in my dreamy state, a vision just came, and it says Hebrews 12:7-8. Now mind you, at this time I have not read the Bible. Okay? I have no clue what is Hebrews. I don't know how many chapters are there or verses. I'm totally clueless. But it says Hebrews 12:7-8, very specifically. I didn't think too much of it, you know. I just continued sleeping. Then I wake up, I say, what's there to lose anyway? I just check it out. Danny bought me a Bible, it's still quite new. So I say, okay, let's try. So I flip to the Old Testament. Hebrews to me sounds like something very ancient, right? It must be in the Old Testament. I flip through the Old Testament. I found no Hebrews there. I was so disappointed. I said, okay, maybe in the New Testament. I said, oh, wow, it's in New Testament, Hebrews. And it says Hebrews 12:7-8. Hebrews 12:7-8 says, endure your hardship as discipline, as God is treating you as His children. I said, whoa. Where did that come from? I was having goose pimples all over my body. You know, I said, this can't be right. I mean, what's the chance of somebody who has never read the Bible to have a vision of a chapter of a specific verse that answers my question directly? Having God talk to me as I was there sleeping, struggling, asking God, why do I have to suffer? Why do I have to suffer this? And God says, endure your hardship as discipline, as God is treating you as a child. Okay. Now at this point, for you know, the chance of that happening is even lesser than my EGFR being positive. There's just no way. There's so many millions or thousands of verses in the Bible. How can I just conjure up something like that? So at that point, I was sold. I said, you win. You win. Okay. I'm convinced. Right? And henceforth, from that day onwards, I started reading the Bible. Right. And the last time I heard the inner voice, that one was a vision, not inner voice, but last time I heard the inner voice was end of April. And that inner voice, same thing, it was in the afternoon, I was sleeping. This time around, I wasn't struggling, just going to sleep. And in a dreamy state, I just heard the inner voice that says, help others in hardship. Okay, it was more like a command rather than a statement. And that's when I embarked on this journey, helping others in hardship. And as I realized that hardship is actually not about being poor. In fact, I think a lot of poor people are probably happier than a lot of us here. Because they're so easily contented with whatever they have, they're probably pretty happy. Hardship can happen to rich people, or whatever. It can be mental hardship, physical hardship, social hardship, etc. And also over the last few months, I start to understand what this true joy is about. In the past, I substitute true joy with pursuing of wealth, you know. I thought that true joy is about pursuing wealth. Why? Because, well, let me just put it this way. In my deathbed, I found no joy in whatever objects that I have. You know? Maybe my Ferrari, thinking of the land I'm going to buy to build my bungalow, and all this. Having this successful business, it brought me zero comfort, zero joy, nothing at all. Right? Thinking I can hold on to this piece of metal, it's going to give me joy. Nah, that's not going to happen. True joy came from interaction with other people. And a lot of times, it is a short-term pride, you know, in the past. When you pursue the wealth, you know, Chinese New Year, best time to do it. Drive my Ferrari, show off to my relatives, show off to all my friends, do my rounds. And then you thought that was true joy. You really think that those guys who saw you in the Ferrari, they share the joy with you. Your relatives, wow, I share this joy with you. In truth, what you have done is just illicit envy, jealousy, or even hatred, you know. They're not sharing the joy with you. And what I have is a short-term pride that, you know, wow, I have something that you don't have, you know. And I thought that there was joy, you know. So what we have is basically a short-term pride at the expense of somebody else, right? And that wasn't true joy. And I found no joy at all, you know, in my deathbed, thinking of, oh, Ferrari, I won't do it. Sayang. True joy, as I discovered, came from interaction. Mm-hmm. Over the last few months, when I'm so down, interaction with my loved ones, my friends, my brothers in Christ, sisters in Christ, when you need them, when you need to be motivated, when you need to be uplifted and all, they share your sorrow, they share your happiness. That's true joy, you know. When we all make you smile, true joy came from helping others in hardship, you know. Because I've gone through this, I know what hardship feels. In fact, some cancer patient tells me that a lot of times people come to them telling them, stay positive, stay positive. Yeah, right. You come in my shoes, you try to stay positive. They don't know what they're talking about. But I have the license. You know. So I've been going out to meet other fellow cancer patients, to share with them, to encourage them. And they know, because I've been through it, you know, and it's easier for me to talk to them, etc. And most importantly, I think true joy comes from knowing God. Yeah. Not knowing about God, you can read the Bible and know about God, but knowing God personally, getting a relationship with God, I think that's the most important, because that's what I've learned. So, if I were to sum it all, you know, I'll say that the earlier we sort out the priorities in our life, the better it is. You know, don't be like me, you know. I had no other way. I had to learn it through the hard way, you know, to come back to God, and to thank Him for this opportunity, because I have 3 major accidents in my past, car accidents. All these sports cars, convertibles, you know, I was always speeding. But somehow I always come out alive from there. Even with the car almost being overturned. You know. And I wouldn't have a chance. You know, I would have been, who knows, I don't know where I would be going to. Even though I was baptized, it was just a show. Listen. But the fact that this has happened gave me a chance to turn back to God. A few things I've learned though. Number one is to love the Lord your God with all your heart. Okay? This is so important. Number two is to love and to serve others, not just ourselves. See? There's nothing wrong with being rich or wealthy. I think it's absolutely alright, because God has blessed the Bible, as you've read. So many people are blessed with good wealth. But the trouble is, I think a lot of us can't handle it. You know? The more we have, the more we want. Mm-hmm. I've gone through that, you know. And the deeper the hole we dig, the more we get sucked into it. So much so that we start to worship wealth and lost focus in God. Instead of worshipping God, we start to worship wealth. And it's just a human instinct. It's just so difficult to get away with. And we are all professionals here. And when you go into private practice or something, you start to build up wealth inevitably. So my thoughts are, if you start to build up wealth when the opportunity comes, do remember that, you know, all these things doesn't belong to us. You know? We think we own it, we have the rights to this wealth. Truth is actually God's gift to us. Mm-hmm. Remember that it's more important to further His kingdom rather than to further ourselves. Okay. For me, I think I've gone through it, and I know that wealth without God is empty. Mm-hmm. It's more important that if you have the wealth, as you're building up subsequently as professionals and all, I think you need to fill up the wealth with God. I think that's about it. I need to share.
Okay.